Спасибо. Евгений Фоминик, Чиравин, кстати, университет. He will talk us about material complexity of classical and virtual three-dimensional.
Thank you. Instead of thanking myself, I should start with a small announcement that we start to restaurant directly from here. The pass will start 5:30, and we plan to start from the order to 5:30-25 about. The bus will stay on the street with the tram line in front of Euler Institute, so and the bus will wait us there, and we will come back to the Anderson Hotel after dinner. And the many most important things that be careful when you leave bus in front of restaurant, because yesterday some car killed a woman there because of traffic. It's crazy traffic. Be careful. Okay. Now I pay my attention to complexity of three manifolds. And first of all, I should say that this is joint work with Andrei Vesnin. And in my talk, there will be two parts. The first part concerning virtual three manifolds, and the second part is applying to this notion and complexity of virtual three manifolds, through calculating complexity of Matvey's complexity of generally three manifolds. So, the part one. What we talk about is virtual three manifolds. This notion was introduced by Sergei Matveyev in his paper 2009, just concerning the introduction of this notion. And to define it, I will start to consider compact three manifold. And consider also triangulation of this manifold. By triangulation, I mean just phase pairing of some tetrahedra. It's not necessary to be simplicial triangulation, but two simplexes can intersect each other more than one phase. Just any triangulation of manifolds. Then to not from compact, okay, it will be closed manifold. Closed manifold. Then to each triangulation we can assign two-dimensional polyhedron P, which is called either special polyhedron or standard polyhedron. Before to explain this situation, let me decrease dimensional into dimensional two and consider just a surface, triangulated surface. Then we can assign to this triangulation so-called the dual graph, which arises as follows. We just consider a barycentric subdivision of this triangulation. Barycentric subdivision, and then first barycentric subdivision, and then we take a length of initial vertices, but in this first barycentric subdivision. So we have three valent graphs. Okay. So we can construct polyhedron T the same manner. We just take and consider first barycentric subdivision and take a length for initial vertices, but in this first barycentric subdivision. I can draw polyhedra inside, it's not for me, for my drawing, but I can explain in another way how to construct this polyhedra. We can consider a boundary of the tetrahedra, which is a two-dimensional sphere, which decomposed into four triangles. And then on this surface, on this sphere, we can take a dual graph to these triangulations. Uh, So we have a dual graph, which is easy to see that this graph is just one skeleton of tetrahedra, homeomorphic to one skeleton of tetrahedra. And then we take a body center of tetrahedra and take a cone over this graph with a vertex in this body center. Okay. We can explain, look at this polyhedron more detailed if we describe what neighborhoods, what kind of points we can have in this polyhedron. It turns out that only three types of points. The first type is non-singular points. We just have a neighborhood, a disk, and we call it non-singular. The second type points is triple points. Have three sheets of paper with common edge. This is triple. And the last one, most important for us, this is so we'll take two vertices. That's exactly what I mean here. We have, if you consider the boundary of such polyhedra, this is exactly one-dimensional skeleton of tetrahedra. And we take a cone over this polyhedra. The last type of point is called a true vertex. So each triangulation we can assign a polyhedron with such neighborhoods, only three types of neighborhoods. And we have two more conditions with this polyhedron. The first one is that each connected component of non-singular points is a disk. And I will call this component either disk or two component. And each connected component of triple points is a segment, just a cell, not a circle. So each triangulation we assign a special polyhedron or standard polyhedron. But okay, let us consider the situation. Can we reverse this map from constructed manifold and triangulation from polyhedron?
It means the closure of this connect component.
No, just connected open.
Is an open?
Open disk, right?
And there is an open interval.
Yes, open cells, right. Okay, let us discuss, can we reverse this arrow just to construct a manifold from an arbitrary special polyhedron with such properties? The answer is that we get sometimes we get a manifold, but sometimes we get so-called manifold with RP2 singularities. And let me describe how it arises. To explain how to construct a manifold from a special polyhedron, let me describe a special polyhedron in a new way. You can consider it as a four-valent graph, which consists of two vertices and stable lines. This is a regular four-valent graph. And then we glue to this graph open disk. Such that, okay, we can consider not open that disk is boundary, such that we map the boundary to this singular graph. So we have a graph and glue a disk to these graphs. Now I'd like to explain this construction. First of all, we can consider the two component disk. And we can imagine that its boundary decomposed into edges, we see how the boundary of this goes through edges of this graph, singular graph. So we decompose the boundary of each non two component into segments, and then we take a point in each segment such that for each segment that there is only one point here, and then we take a point inside the disk, and then we join this point with by arc with each point on its boundary. So that means that here we have three arcs, and so here just we can consider that this arc is just exactly this is the vertex inside a disk, and we cut. Okay, we decompose, we draw these arcs, and then we cut out our polyhedron P along these lines. And exactly what we will have, we get a number of such polyhedra, neighborhood of the two vertices. Then, we can imagine that our polyhedra lies inside the tetrahedra. Each such neighborhood of three vertices line belongs to a tetrahedra. And then we can glue these neighborhoods back to the polyhedron P. And this gives us the rule how to glue this tetrahedra by phase pairing, because in each phase we have three edges, and we know how to glue this triode with each other. So we have a gluing of tetrahedra. So that's all. We starting from P and get a phase pairing of tetrahedra. But it's well known that if you phase parent tetrahedra, as a result you get three manifold with singularities. But there are only there are only two types of singularities in this case. The first singularities can arise in vertices of tetrahedra, and it may be a cone over any closed surface. The first type of singularities, and the second type of singularities arises in the edges. You can get a point which have a neighborhood which is a cone over RP2 with vertices in this middle point. So and the last step describing this manifold, we just cut off all vertices. So it means that we glue not tetrahedra, but truncated tetrahedra. So it allows avoid singularities here. But it may happen that we still have singularities on edges. So as a result, we get compact three manifold with non-empty boundary, and this is we can have some RP2 singularities. Okay, then let me explain. Well-known transformation for special polyhedra. This transformation holds or moves on special set of special polyhedra. This is so-called Matveyev-Gergerini moves. Okay, please correct me if I'm not right.
Yeah, you need 2L, please.
2L, let's see. This move He plays a neighborhood of two vertices in a special polyhedron with another neighborhood which contains exactly three vertices. Let me draw a picture. Which goes along this heads and caps and edge. And then we replace this smooth, so adding more by T, we replace this by a tube with the middle disk. And exactly. Again, three rings. So here we have two vertices. Here we have three vertices. But we can explain this move in terms of triangulations. It's so called equivalent to three path moves. So if instead of special polyhedron, we consider a manifold. Imagine that this is a natural manifold without singularities, with triangulated manifold. Then we can replace this move by this common two-dimensional phase, and we can replace this by just deleting the middle phase and adding a new edge from north to south, such that we have three tetrahedra, which is like a slice of orange. So we have a move on the set of polyhedra, and now we can define what virtual manifold is. Let us think that we consider only special polyhedra with two or more two vertices. Just forget about special polyhedra with one vertice, just to avoid some difficulties to explain. So, we say that two polyhedra, special polyhedra, are equivalent. We can only if we can go from one polyhedra to the second one, just applying moves T and its inverse, some number of these moves. And then by virtual manifolds, Matveyev defines class equivalence class of such polyhedra. A few properties of virtual manifolds. First of all, that of course virtual manifolds. What I will need for my talk, that virtual manifolds has a Euler characteristic because it's survive under these moves. And also what is important for me that derived Pirov invariants. Also defined for virtual manifolds, not only for the dimensional manifold, because of this move again. So, how how is virtual manifolds related with general tree manifolds without singularities? If we can, the first theorem was formulated in Matveev's paper I mentioned before, says that we can extend a map which assigns P a manifold with RP2 singularities up to a map from X to Y, where X is a set of all virtual manifolds to the set of all three manifolds with boundary and RP2 singularities. So it means, just simply means that if we apply to a polyhedron P a move P, it means that the first polyhedron and the resulting polyhedron we assign them the same manifold. This map is surjective. It's surjective, but it's unknown, is it injective? And other remark that if we restrict our consideration only with polyhedra which embedded in some three-dimensional manifolds, that means that we have one-to-one correspondence between these types of polyhedra, between virtual manifolds and three-dimensional manifolds with boundary. So for signable polyhedra which can be embedded in the three manifolds, we have a bijection, but for non-signable there is just a surjective, but we don't know about injection. Now we can define, followed by Matveev's idea, we can define a complexity for a virtual manifold, just saying that complexity of a virtual manifold is equal to n if there exists a special polyhedron P1 in plus P with exactly n vertices. And the second condition, that there are no complexity is a minimal number of two vertices arising in a class of polyhedra. So the question, can we, for what virtual manifolds we can find its complexity? And let me give you some examples. The first that is very evident that if a special polyhedron P has exactly two vertices, then complexity of corresponding virtual manifold is exactly by definition, because we start from polyhedra with two vertices. But of course, it's not so interesting result. But the second result is more interesting. I will mark it as a theorem. And I give an example with infinite family of virtual manifolds. Okay, the second theorem says that if a special polyhedron P has n two vertices, n two vertices, n exactly one component. Then complexity of corresponding virtual manifold is equal to n. It means that this is a minimal polyhedron in this class. So this condition is the main condition in this case. The idea's proof is very simple. Suppose that we have another polyhedron which is equivalent to P, and this polyhedron contains, say, P two vertices and D two components. Then the Euler characteristic of P prime is equals to D minus A. It's easy because special polyhedron is just a regular covariant graph, so we have k vertices and we have correspondingly 2k edges, and we have d disk, so just easy calculation give us such Euler characteristic. But this Euler characteristic is equivalent to Euler characteristic of P. And so we see that for any special polyhedron in the class, the difference between the number of disks in this polyhedron and the number of covers is a constant. So it means that if you have a polyhedron with a minimal number of two vertices, then this polyhedron should have a minimal number of two components because of this relation. But our polyhedron P has a minimal minimal possible number of two components, just one. So it should have the minimal number of two vertices. Let's finish proof of this theorem. In this case, we construct the infinite family of virtual manifolds with known value of complexity. And what is the new theorem? Let me present your new one. This theorem states that almost all polyhedra with two components are minimal. Okay. It states that let P be a special polyhedron with n two vertices. And two components. Then if he admits T minus 1, so we can directly decrease the number of vertices. You can go from here to here, from right to left. Then the complexity of the corresponding virtual manifold is equal to n minus 1. Another case, this polyhedron is minimal one and the complexity is equal to n. Okay, let me give a sketch of proof of this theorem. Of course, when P admits transformation T minus 1, it's very evident because our polyhedron P has two components. And when we apply T minus 1, we decrease the number of vertices by 1 and decrease the number of two components by 1. So it goes from P to P prime, which has n minus 1 two vertices and exactly one two component. But according to the previous theorem, this polyhedron is a minimal, so the complexity is exactly n minus 1. The difficult part of theorem is when we can't apply directed T minus 1, and we need to prove why we can't decrease the number of vertices just applying some T plus 1, then T minus 1. And the proof is based on trifero invariance, and it's nice part of this invariant, so called epsilon invariant of Matveyev, Ovchinnikov, and Sokolov. Maybe I just briefly describe situation. Okay, we have a situation that P doesn't admit it's impossible to apply T minus 1, but nevertheless, by quasi contrary, suppose that it's not a minimal polyhedron, then it should be polyhedron P prime, special polyhedron P prime, which is equivalent to P. And P prime, as the previous, has n minus 1 two vertices, and exactly one two component. Then we can prove that from this assumption that P prime equivalent P, we can say very interesting information about P. What we can say exactly? We can say that this polyhedron P has a subpolyhedron Q, which is a so-called simple subpolyhedron. Simply means that this polyhedron has three types of points, which is still you can see here, just a non-singular optimal line and two vertices. But it's not necessary that non-singular points are open disk and triple lines are open segments. So this is not included in the definition of single. So just types of neighborhoods. So from this condition we get that P has such a polyhedron. And moreover, as we know that P has two components, and we can describe how components go through singular graphs. Just you can say that there are two conditions, that there is a two component. Beta, and such that in neighborhood of each edge, we have one of the two situations that either two component beta doesn't go through an edge, so these three parts belong to another two component, or situation when beta attaches an edge just once. This is about how it goes through edges, and the, another how it goes through vertices. So beta, let me say that the boundary curve means that if you consider a disk and glue it to a graph, you have a boundary curve on this graph of this beta. So boundary curve intersects only exactly three vertices, and in neighborhood of these three vertices, we have a situation as follows: that beta goes as here, or beta goes like here. This one. So let me just repeat again. We suppose that P is not minimal, construct P prime with a smaller number of vertices and disk, and then just calculate it. So epsilon invariant of Matveyev Sokolov at Chinnikov, I have no time to describe it. We it's followed that there is a polyhedron Q with such properties that P minus Q is a beta, and beta goes as follows. And then just calculating derived Pirouet invariant of degree 7 for this polyhedron P and for polyhedron P prime, we see that this invariant is different. So we have a contradiction to existence of such polyhedron P prime, and we prove a theory. So here I stop with virtual manifolds, and let me say to continue the second part, which is smaller than the first part, and give you how to apply this complexity of virtual manifolds for Matveyev's complexity of three manifolds. First of all, let me remind what is Matveyev's complexity of three manifold. We need to explain three types of polyhedra. You know what is a special one. Let me remind a simple one, a simple polyhedra. Means that we have only three types of points, non-singular, triple point, and two vertices. This is simple polyhedra. And the last type of polyhedra is called always simple. Almost simple. It means that this polyhedra can be embedded in some simple one. So simple, almost simple, embedded in some simple polyhedra. And we consider three types of this polyhedra: special, simple, and almost simple, as a spine of three manifold. And let me remind that by definition, two-dimensional polyhedron P is a spine of three manifold M. If either M is closed and M minus P is just an open ball, or M has an empty boundary, and M minus P is geometric to a direct product of the boundary in the semi interval. And I should mention, when we started our when I started my talk with closed manifold and this triangulation and correspond a special polyhedron. This polyhedron exactly a spine of manifold, but not the initial one, but we need to cut off a neighborhood of vertices of the triangulation. So this constructed polyhedron was a spine of manifold with diluted neighborhoods of vertices. So it's a difficult problem to calculate material complexity. Material complexity is certain as in the case of virtual manifold is equal m if there is a if there is an almost simple spine. There are no almost simple spines of M with smaller number of vertices. The problem of calculating material complexity is very difficult because of the second condition, how because there are no almost simple spines with smaller number of vertices. And the second problem is that almost simple spines by themselves are more difficult objects than a special one. And it would be better to work with special spine instead of almost simple spine. And Matvey proved a very nice theorem. Which says that, that if we special spine. Find the minimal spine, not the bad class of almost simple polyhedron, but the which in the class
irreducible.
Ah, closed, yes. Irreducible. But in the more easiest class of special polyhedron to find the minimal spines. And according to this theorem, we can formulate, we can apply results concerning virtual manifold with two disks with two components to three and virtual manifold with one disk to find matrix complexity for infinite family of families of three manifolds. First result was proved by easy fact that if P is a special spine of a manifold N, then you can compare the complexity of manifold N and the complexity of virtual manifold corresponding to P. It's as follows: that the complexity of N is less or equal to virtual complexity of P, because virtual complexity of P is less or equal than the number of vertices of P, but is a spine of M, and the vertices of any spine of M give us an upper bound for complexity of M, because maybe a spine with smaller number of vertices. But according to this theorem, if M is as in Matvey's theorem, then we can state that these two complexities are equivalent to each other, close to each other. Because in case of Matvey theorem, we stick to finding complexity to the class of special spines, and so this is the same. And now let me just give two examples. The first example belongs to Frigerio Martelli and Petronio. They proved that let P be a special spine of three-dimensional manifold M, and P has M through vertices and exactly one two component. Then Matvey's complexity of such manifold is equal to M. The proof is just combination of second example about virtual manifolds and Matvey's theorem. The new result proved by Frigerio Martelli Petronio. First of all, they proved that in this situation, manifold M is a hyperbolic manifold with a totally geodesic bounded. This is quite new, and then we applied just Matvey's theorem, for which says that we should consider only class of special spine for finding complexity. And my example I gave before says that if you have this polyhedron with exactly one component, it's minimal, so we know the complexity then, and so we know the complexity of manifold M. And the second example belongs to Andrei Vesninok and me. When we consider manifolds which have a special spine with two components, it's so called, which illustrates the second theorem. This manifold is called so called Paul-Lutzig-Zimmermann manifold. Paul-Lutzig-Zimmermann manifold. This manifold constructed as follows. Suppose we have N which is more greater than 3, and we have another parameter K, and such that Gregg common division of N to 2 minus K equal to 1, and consider by pyramid this is vertices N, S, L, 0, L1, so on, L, N minus 1. And then we glue each upper tetrahedron with some upper triangle with some lower triangle by the following rule. Oh, I'm almost stopped. Sorry. And why? Why was 1M doing 2 S L plus K right plus 1 plus P? And in this case, we have a singular manifold that we will get manifold all vertices of this bipyramid will to exactly one vertex. We will have a singularity there, and we got all this singularity, and we will get a manifold with boundary. This condition gives us that all edges of bipyramid glue to exactly one edge, and this means that dual polyhedron special spine, which have exactly two-dimensional components, which is goes around this edge and the second edge, which goes from N to S. And for these manifolds, it's known by from Pauli Zimmermann that all these manifolds are hyperbolic. So we calculating complexity, we use the virtual complexity instead of this complexity. And as follows from theorem of virtual complexity for polyhedra with two-dimensional parts, its complexity exactly this dual polyhedron is a minimal spine, so we have a complexity which is equal to n, because we can decompose into n tetrahedra, so we have n tetrahedra. So thank you very much.
Well, not quite related to exactly what I was talking about. What is known about the complexity of finite powers, for example, in the hyperbolic case? How complexity of manifold and some finite covering manifold may be related? Can the recovering space lower complexity than this one?
There are some upper bounds, but that's
it. Well, upper bounds is obvious. Just multiply by the number of sheets, yes? But can it be smaller, for example?
Sphere and cube.
Yeah, I told hyperbolic. Yeah. Of course, for spherical manifolds.
For example, for tetrahedral manifolds, on top of Andrei, they just multiply just for tetrahedral, we have a covering has a complexity.
Exactly
right.
Exactly.
Because of
but other cases where the complexity is much lower than some more.
It's not a question but a comment. So I made some on the board observation that Turay-Leroy invariant are extremely efficient for proving negative results. I mean that this and this manifolds are different to distinguish between manifolds. But here we met, I think only one, I don't know other examples, when Turay-Leroy invariants are useful for obtaining positive results. Just this is an invariant, how we call it?
Epsilon.
Epsilon invariant, it turned to be useful to prove a positive result that the complexity is on is this and this one. All other applications of quantum invariants are just produce negative results.
Okay.